I'm excited. We're doing this.
You didn't like my idea. But okay. Hello, 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 and welcome to another episode of the Big Money Stylist podcast. Every week, Ani and I, so in the beginning when we started our podcast, we would like come with like the most like crazy planned out frame ever, yeah. But we've been doing like, what is this, 195,000? I don't know. We've gotten some reps doing our podcast. So what we typically do is about 5 minutes before the show, we're like, what do they need to hear? What do they want to hear? And you know, it's so crazy. I always feel like they're pretty good. I listen to our own podcast. I always joke around. I'm like,
I like it.
I'm a fan. But I always am surprised how many people tag us on side of Instagram. They're like, I needed to hear this today. Thank you. I needed to hear this today. So we really try to tap into like, what's going on? What do artists need to hear? What do entrepreneurs need to hear? What do women need to hear? What do people need to hear right now? And that's kind of what we base our conversation on. So today we were like, all right, what do we want to talk about? And Ani wants to talk about surfing because
I don't want to talk about surfing.
All of a sudden she's a pro surfer.
Hey, it's like when you're like, I went to church and I'm like, I went surfing. Oh, I'm doing the same thing. No, you know what? I really want to talk about how all of your fears are way worse in your head.
Yeah.
Like seriously, like every single thing that you are afraid of,
right.
You are making it out to be a big, super gigantic fucking monster in your head.
Yeah, we blow it out of proportion to the, especially, I mean, I don't know if men do this as much, but like, women, like I have anxiety, I'm not gonna lie. And yeah. I'll know when my anxiety is creeping in because I'll like take this little tiny thing and I'll be like, and I blow it into like a giant story. And then I'm like talking to my daughters. I'm like, you can't ever leave the house. I'm gonna tie you to the chair. Something, no. Like, she's like, Mom, I just wanna walk to Starbucks. I'm like, no.
But if you walk to Starbucks, someone could stop and then they could take you. And if they take you, then I'm never gonna get you. And then you're dead. If you go to Starbucks, like, you die. Yeah,
literally, that's where it goes.
What the fuck?
I can't go to Starbucks, Mom, because I'm gonna die. And I don't say that, but I'm secretly, I'm like, okay, that's a lot. She's probably not going to die walking to Starbucks.
You know what, though? I can give you an example for artists. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Artists are always like, well, I need to raise my prices, but if I raise my prices, I'm going to lose a lot of my clientele. If I lose a lot of my clientele, then I'm not going to make any money. If I'm not making any money, then I can't afford my house or food. If I can't afford my house or food, me and my children, we're going to be living on the street and they're going to be starving. If I raise my prices, my children will starve to death. I'm like, what? What?
You're like, but it's like, honestly, if you say something like that out, you're like, well, that does sound a little bit ridiculous.
How fucking ridiculous to you sound.
But you know what? I think not only that, but it comes down to lack of confidence and of like actually doing something different, right? It's like scary. Like, why is that funny?
Go ahead.
I was going to say, I think that we use these excuses like, yeah, my children's going to die. But if you really actually play that out in your mind, you know that's not going to happen. So what's your excuse? Now you have no excuse. Like, literally, you're like, okay, my kids are not going to starve together. So why is it so uncomfortable? Why can't I raise my prices? What the key word, it is uncomfortable. So we live in this land of uncomfortable in fear of failure. And it's just, and we think like it's going to get worse, but you're already in this place where you're uncomfortable.
Well, you know what? Let's talk about confidence for a second. And I'm someone, guys, I teach and train and I actually learn through stories better than someone just giving me a bullet point list. And Emily's a perfect fucking example. I wanted to go surfing last weekend. And my coach was straight up like, no. And I'm like, why? And he's like, there are 9-foot waves here. Like, you can't surf that. I'm like, I can totally do that. I'm like, I can do that. He's like, Ani, you've only
like
ever
your confidence.
Surfed. He's like, you've surfed 4-foot waves. I'm like, yeah, but 4-foot wave plus 5-foot me, we're at 9 feet. I think I can do this. And he's like dying laughing. And he was straight up like, no, like you're not going to do it.
You're not there yet.
Yeah. And we were laughing yesterday as we're out surfing yesterday. And I was like, you know what? I realized that I have a very like, not a false sense of confidence, but maybe like an elated sense of confidence where I hear something and I'm like, I can do that. Fuck yeah, I can do that. Maybe not easy, but I can do it.
It's like when you see like what you see on Pinterest, which it actually looks like. And you're, oh, in my mind,
nailed it.
I was that girl, but no.
Yeah, and that's something that I realized. Like even when I was talking to him yesterday, I'm like, I hear things like 9-foot wave, and I'm like, yeah, I can do that. Can I actually? No, I actually cannot. For the simple fact of I cannot hold my breath long enough if I get knocked off of that wave. So no, I am not that. Like literally,
you think you're like Kelly Slater? You're like, I'm totally like carving in and out of these waves, and then you see a video of yourself and you're like, I'm balanced on the waves. That's a start.
Oh shit. Every video I see, I send it to my coach and I go, this is what I think I look like, but I know I don't look like this. But seriously, but I realized yesterday, I'm like, man, even like when I moved here and Garrett was like, all right, Ani, you ready? I'm like, I'm ready. What am I doing? He's like, you're going to get on stage in front of 200 people and you're going to teach this. And I was like,
no,
mother, what? And then I was like, Yeah, I can do that. I can get in front of anybody. I can get in front of anybody and teach anything. Is that true? No, I am nervous for about 90% of the things I do. But instead of going into things and being like, I'm so scared, I'm going to fuck it up. Oh my God, I'm going to be the worst. This is terrible. I'm not going to do it. I literally go complete opposite. And I'm like, I got this. I'm going
to
nail this.
Well, you have to go into something with that certain level of certainty. Because if you don't, you will kind of fall on your face, right?
Yeah.
Well, so it's not a problem to have that level of certainty. Otherwise, you wouldn't try anything new.
And and that's weirdly something he said to me yesterday, because he looked at a wave that was coming and he goes, you know what? He goes, this is going to be too big for you. And I go, I got it. Let's do it. And he was like, well, I'm like, let's go. I'm like, let's do it. And so he's like, has to help me over the wave. But I did it and it was great. And he said, you know, that's when I was laughing about my like false level of like certainty and confidence. And he goes, but that's good. He goes, because I see so many students, and I want you guys to understand this happens in every industry. And I realized that he goes, they see something and they go, they overthink it to where they're like, yeah, I can't know because what if, but then to where then they end up doing nothing. They don't go over the wave. They don't do the live video. They literally do absolutely nothing. And so
it's going to go live. It won't let me go live.
That's fine. Okay. So that's why I think, you know, is it the best that I amp myself up? I'm like,
I don't think that's a problem. You have to have a certain level of certainty. Let's see if I can do this.
You can't talk and do it at the same time.
I can't.
But I agree. Know how to do it live I do anymore. Think it's that there's a difference between, because I literally asked, I was like, am I fucking delusional? And he's like, no. He goes, I go, is being this confident a strength or am I being delusional? And he goes, I think that's a strength because it does. It keeps me from playing small. Because if I look at everything and I'm like, that's too big, that's scary, I can't do that, I'm not that person, I'm not good enough.
I give up. I don't know how to do life.
That's okay. We're in the middle of a podcast. But if like that's what I'm always thinking, then yeah, I'm never going to get outside of my comfort zone. And we see that with students.
I was going to go live because I actually hate going live. So I was going to make myself go live, but I don't know how.
So, but that's what happens though. And we see that inside of every single class, sucker.
How did you do that?
Because I'm a fucking genius.
Put it on my phone.
You need to talk.
I'll share a story.
Share
okay.
A fucking, what are we even talking about, Danielle?
No, so when I first started my brand 10 years ago, I remember being on Pinterest and being that guy and I would see all these beautiful photos and I was like, oh my God, like my work's that good. I wonder why I don't have this amazing giant following. Like I could totally be that person. Like I could do that. I'm totally there. All I need to do is just, you know, start and I'm already there. And so it takes this level of certainty to start anything, but acknowledging where you're currently at. Like seriously.
Yes. And that's why I think it's good to be confident and be like, you know what? I'm not sure if I can do this, but I'm going to do this. Or to be like, I'm not good. I don't care. Or if you look at it and you're like, I'm never going to be that person, that still keeps you from stopping.
Right.
And that's a problem. You can't just keep yourself from doing something because you think you're never going to get there. And you're right. You're never going to get there if you don't start somewhere. I will be surfing a 9-foot wave one day, but I'm not going to get there if I don't start with the little baby waves at Doheny Beach that are like 4 inches
tall.
But
you also have to give yourself feedback on where you're at.
Yeah.
So in the beginning, like I would literally take photos of my work and then I had this like reality check where I was like, I'm like holding it up to like, you know, these like professional Redken photos or whatever it is, Paul Mitchell photos. And I'm like, okay, all right. Well, I think I'm good, but I'm not quite there yet. So I had to really be like, okay, well, how do I get there? And self-feedback is so important in taking that next step to get to where you want to go. Certainty, you need certainty to get going. But you also have to be willing to give yourself feedback and not be in this place of la-la land of like, I'm totally there. Because that's like your ego talking. And guess what? You're not there. You're not there and you won't be there unless you can figure out how to take the steps required to get there. And the other thing I see is people think too far in the future. And I've shared this on another podcast, but I had an artist one time come up to me in a class and she's like, so Danielle, okay, so I'm going to buy this salon. I'm going to do this and this and this. And I was like, wait, whoa, slow up. Do you have an assistant? She's like, well, no. And
no.
I'm like, do not worry about purchasing a salon right now when you don't have an assistant. Do you have a full book of MBR? No. Okay. Let's start with building a book of MBR. Then let's move to training an assistant.
Yep.
Then let's just see where that goes. Then maybe let's rent a studio suite. And then maybe let's see how, let's maybe go purchase a salon.
Guys, it's baby steps. Well, and that's you have to start small to get big.
The biggest mistake I see entrepreneurs do is they're like, for example, I had a sister-in-law who's she's like, I'm going to go open a gym. And she didn't have like a following or anything. She was like, I'm going to go open a gym and just market. And I did it the opposite. I'm like, I'm going to build my following. I'm going to build reps because there's I have to become the expert for people to want to come to me, right? So a lot of entrepreneurs just like open a shop and think if I build it, they will come. And it's like, well, no, now you got a shit ton of overhead and you haven't actually worked on perfecting your craft and becoming an expert in what you do. So I think it's so important to really like get some reps in and worry about where you're at right now and know to who you can become and who you can build to be.
But it's a matter of fear. People are so afraid of being labeled as a failure, or saying that they like fucked up or couldn't do it, that it keeps them from starting, which is why I say the fear that you have in your head is bigger than the reality. Right. And I go back to that girl from class where we said, you're going to do a live video. And she walked outside, came back in and looked me in my face and said, I'm not doing it. I'm like,
you're like, why are you here?
Like, that's good luck if you think I would ever accept that in any of our classes. Like, that's not. And so I literally looked at her and I said, what's the worst thing that could happen? Tell me, what is the all time, like, down and dirty worst thing that could happen? And she looked at me.
She's like, I feel stupid. And you're like,
well, no, that's not even what she said. I kept looking at her. I was like, well, and she's like, well, nothing. I go, then what's the fucking problem?
But the problem is a lot of times people like just something as simple as like going live or like doing a video. Literally, like, a lot of artists are very introverted, and they're like, I'm not going to do it, and they're, like, sweating. I'm like...
Because it's the fear in their head, because they think, if I go live, million people are going to see I'm going to stutter, I'm going to sound stupid, no one's going to like me, I'm going to lose followings. None of that is going to happen. The most that might happen is 5 people might see it.
And I always like to say, well, if you feel stupid for a minute, but you made it, you know, a couple $1,000, is that worth it? And they're like,
I always say, I'm willing to be uncomfortable for 2 minutes
totally,
for $2,000.
Like, I totally.
That sounds dirty. First off, we need to rewind that. I am willing comes to marketing, yes. I am willing to be uncomfortable if that will bring me my dream clientele. I think I just made myself seem like a prostitute.
I will do anything for money. Well, hold on. Let's keep it classy.
I will be No, I don't even want to say that statement anymore because now that's embarrassing. But that's what I'm saying, guys. The fear, and I'm going back to what I know, and I actually have a question about you about fear.
Ooh.
Is, guys, when I started surfing, I was like, this is what's going to happen. I'm going to get in the ocean. One wave is going to hit me. I'm going to fucking die. Like, I'm telling you. And guys, today I went surfing at 6:30 this morning, and honestly, my worst fear pretty much came to life. I got wrecked off my board.
You surfed the Strand. That's gnarly.
Oh, yeah. It was the biggest waves and the fastest waves and the most powerful. It was really scary. And I got knocked off my board and the wave hit me at like the worst part. And the waves at the Strand push you down. And that's my fear of getting pushed down and not being able to come back up. And for it was probably only 2 seconds.
But what did you do when you were in that space of panic? What could you do?
First off, nothing. The wave is going to do whatever the hell it wants to until it chooses to let you go. But I sat there and I for 2 seconds, I was like, like panic, like, oh God, I'm going to fucking die. And then I remembered what my coach said. The wave will let you go, but you have to remain calm and you just have to count. So literally in my head, I'm going 1, 2, and I counted. I only made it up to 5 until I literally hit the bottom. The wave let me go and I pushed myself back up. But that for me was my biggest fear. And guess what? Even though I thought I was going to fucking drown, it was nowhere near as bad as I thought it was going to be.
But what's so crazy is there's been so many times in my life where there's literally like, I gotta submit. There's literally nothing I can do. And when I get to this level of submission, there's this calm that comes over me.
Yep.
And I actually feel like I do better under pressure. You can end mine too.
I don't know what happened. It died. But it's true that you do have to submit at some point. And that's what I'm saying, guys. My biggest fear was literally drowning in the ocean and not being able to come back up. And it happened. I got shoved down to where my coach even said, there was nothing I could do to help you. I just had to see how you came back up. I'm like, that's utterly terrifying. But in it, I stayed calm. And guess what? By the time I got back up, I was like, that wasn't fun. I didn't like it. But guess what? It wasn't as bad as I thought, which lets me know the fear I had in my head, I was making it out to be some big, massive thing when that's not actually the case.
Right.
And even like when it comes to marketing, guys, it's a video. Oh, for fuck's sake. I'm live right now on my Instagram and no one's yelling at me, telling me that I'm garbage. Like, they're just listening. Like, right. It's never as bad as you think it is. So but, dropping those clients,
yeah,
upping your prices, you're not going to lose your house.
I also think it comes down to who you hold yourself and your identity. So mm-hmm. I've seen artists that have been doing hair for 20 years or whatever, and they're like, well, I can't get uncomfortable because I'm too established. And I'm like, since when?
What?
So you're done growing because you're too established? So you're done? So you're just going to stay there?
So you just roll over and die? That's it?
You roll over? Like, you're not, like, you're too set and, like, you know, being a massive salon owner, but maybe your salon's not even making that much money. Like, at that point, you have to understand the point of pain that you're at and submit to, like, hey, like, I've got to let go in order to grow. Like, honestly.
Well, and I think even what you said about the path and people being like, well, I want to be that. I think sometimes the where, like the end goal that people come up with, they're like, if I reach that, I've made it. So they do it. They make it. And then they're like, I made it. I'm done.
Yeah. And then, crickets, but you know what though?
Blink, blink.
I've hit that place a lot of times in my life where I'm like, wow, I thought when I got to this point, like I'd be like, I'm stoked. I'm yeah. done. And I tell Garrett this all the time. I go, we're living in the pocket. He's like, what do you mean? I go, there's people with a shit ton of money that wish they were us. Not saying that we're not successful and we don't have money, but we are constantly looking to grow. And at no matter what level we're at, like we just bought the most phenomenal dream house in California where I was like, where do we go from here? But it gets fun at that point because you're like, exactly, how do I push myself to be uncomfortable? What can I create? And true producers and creators have that mindset. And you're really selling yourself out by saying like, what if, because I've shared this so many times, like we don't understand the impact that we can have on not just like ourselves, but on, you know, our family members, our communities. Like there's so many people that by not getting uncomfortable, you have no idea the impact that you can make, whether you believe it's a small impact or a big impact. Even think about your children. What if the impact that you make on your children is so massive that you have a son or daughter or whatever that goes on and creates a legacy because of the impact that you had and your ability to get uncomfortable. I'm not saying you have to be massive, but I do believe that living life is all about growing and trying to figure out how to become the best person that you possibly can. And that starts with getting out of your own way, getting out of your head. When you create these elaborate stories in your mind, really have a moment where you count to five under the waves and ask yourself, like, is this true? Like, just have that moment to yourself and say, is this really happening? And this calm will come over you and you'll be able to make clear, concise decisions in your life and in your business that now logically make sense.
Well, and I feel you can't let yourself hit panic mode either. Mm-hmm. And panic mode will come, truly, especially for artists. I'm talking to you when you up your prices or you start dropping clients and you see mm-hmm. that first gap in your day and ooh. You're like, I'm supposed to go like that! And you start panicking. Don't. You know,
you have to have boundaries.
You know, that happened to me this morning.
Oh.
I was at your house, actually. I looked out at the ocean and I was like, Finn, shark, she's fucking shark. No, guys, it was just a little pot of dolphin or a ton of dolphin out there. But literally for half a second, I was like, shark. And then I was like, oh, calm down. That's not a shark. It's a ton of dolphin. But even like, I feel like that's what happens. We go to worst case scenario.
Right.
If I do this, what's the all time worst case scenario thing that could happen?
What's the best case scenario?
Yeah. Well, and that's what I'm saying. Like sometimes we go to worst case and we stay at worst case and we assume worst case is true. As opposed to, well, what is the best thing that could come out of this? And right. then truly it becomes a juggling game. Is it worth getting out of my comfort zone and quote unquote risking it or whatever for that outcome? Does the good outweigh the bad? And I'm telling you, the good always outweighs the bad if you're willing to see it.
Right.
If you're not, and you're always putting yourself in a place of like, nope, this could go wrong. Someone might not like me. Someone might say this might happen. I might lose this client. Someone will be mad. And okay.
I have to say there's this place too with inside of our business where we get to this place where we're like, I can't want more in life. I have to just be grateful for where I'm at. There's nothing wrong with being grateful, but there's also nothing wrong with wanting more. And if more means more money, more success, more whatever it is, there's nothing wrong with that. So I think that a lot of times we say, no, Don't play. That's an excuse. Like, there's nothing wrong with being grateful, but don't let the excuse of saying you're grateful hold you back from what you're meant to do. Which, you guys, this is like, it's crazy as it sounds. Like, start small. Literally, start with where you're at. Work on being a better human being, a better mom, a better artist, a better business owner, a better whatever it is. Start with little consistencies. And throughout, like, what I love in the academy, that's so cool, like, to see artists, like, when they first start, I feel like they're little babies. And then, like, it's a year-long program. By the time they get out of the program, I'm like, you're a different human being. Like, it's so cool to watch them do that. You know what I mean?
Well, and that's why even talking about gratitude, I think it's, I hear a lot of artists say, they're like, well, I feel bad saying I want more, because then it feels like I'm saying that I'm unhappy where I'm at. And I'm like, wait a minute. No, let's think about, let's go to food real quick. Let's think about a steak. And I don't know much about steak, but I know some are very expensive. So let's say you just get like a normal little piece of steak and you cook it at home and you eat it. Was it delicious? Yes. Did you enjoy it? Fuck yeah. It's steak. It's so good. Still, does that mean that you don't want to go to, oh my God, Bourbon at the Waldorf Astoria? Girl, so that's the best steak. And pay $200 for a steak and that will be the most tender, delicious steak you've ever had? Yes, I still want to do that. Do I want to eat my steak at home because I love it? Yes, and I'm so grateful for it, and I had a great time. I never cooked. That's a lie. I love that my boyfriend cooked it. It was delicious. Do I also want to go to Bourbon and have their steak? Right. Yes. Wanting something different, something more, doesn't mean you're a bad person. Doesn't make you a bad person, and it doesn't mean you hate the thing of where you're at.
Right.
I have always said, I will forever appreciate where I was when I was that person in Missouri.
Right.
Had I never been her and gotten so far out of my comfort zone that it was like a different universe, I wouldn't be the person I am today. Does that mean I want to move back to Missouri? No. Does that mean I want to go back to working in a suite? No. No, it doesn't. There are a lot of things that I've grown out of.
Right.
Not because they were bad, because I grew.
Right.
And that's something that I think should be celebrated, not been like, oh, she doesn't care. She's ungrateful. She's so self-centered. Well, fuck you. It's my life. So, and it's your life.
Right.
So if it makes you happy, do it. If you're like, my clientele is great, but it could be better, because I'm telling you right now, anytime an artist comes to us the first time and I'm like, what would you change about your clientele? And they're like, nothing. I'm like, you're a fucking liar and you're delusional. You are not actually looking at your eyes through, like, you're looking at it through almost your eyes. You're not, like, taking a step back.
You're like,
back.
Well, I'm just grateful I have a full book of business. But do you, like, do you enjoy going to work? Do you enjoy
But is it
all
ideal?
Your clients?
Are you really that happy with it? And they're not, but they feel bad saying, I don't
but
want
sometimes
this.
You, honestly, Ani, like, I've gone through so much in my life. And when I look back, I'm like, those were tough. Those are some gnarly years. Like, I call them the dark years. But there's moments of where I'm like, I'm happy and I'm with my kids and I'm happy with my husband. And there's times I'm not happy with my husband. There's moments inside of even the dark years where I was like,
they're pockets of happiness.
I was like, it wasn't like I was super miserable. But now if you were like, hey, do you want to go back there? I'm like, absolutely not. And looking through how much I've had to grow and evolve, I'm like, I'm a different human being and I can't go back that way. Like, I'm not interested in going back that way, even though there was moments of happiness. And one of the things we ask in our classes is like, hey, like the first thing we ask them is like, what do you want and why are you here? Like, we get it. It's a hair extension class. But like our brand, this brand is not just about the hair extension system. If you guys have been listening to the podcast for a while, you know we're not just about beads and string and that kind of shit. And it's so funny because a lot of them, they have this guilt where when they're like, I want more money and I want it for me. And I'm like, there's nothing wrong with that. And I always use the parable of like, when you're on an airplane, you have to put your gas mask on before you put anybody else's gas mask on. Sometimes helping yourself and giving yourself that permission and letting go of that guilt is the first thing you can do to actually help other people.
Well, and the way that I look at it with what you said of things, there's pockets of good. But surrounding it is not. And I'm going to use the most extreme example I can think of, an abusive relationship. Where it's fucked and you know it's messed up and you know it's not okay and you know you deserve more, but there's that one instance where that person shows you kindness and care and they treat you well that you're like, maybe I can stay here. Because you're willing to put aside all the negative and all the bad for that one small glimpse of like sunlight when really most of the days are dark. And the same goes with business. Right. And for artists, like, I speak to you because I am you, because I've been in that situation where I'm like, I mean, yes, I worked 14 hours today. And yes, I'm working two jobs 7 days a week in order just to pay my bills. But like, my clients are so fun. Yeah. Okay, but is...
But I love what I do.
And that's... Yeah. If I look at something and I'm like, this is not ideal. Yeah. It is not my ideal life. Then it doesn't matter. I'm going to change it.
And I always feel... I feel like artists are such passionate people and we take so much pride in our craft. And we love... Like, when we do, like, a really good balayage or extension or, like, whatever it is, geek out so much. We love it so much. We almost... That's why we discount. That's why artists discount. Because they are so fulfilled in the art and the happiness that creates for that client. They don't view themselves as the prize. And they're like, well, I mean, I just won't charge them for this toner and I won't charge them for this... You know, this... And they don't tell them that. So then they charge them, say I'm just going to throw out a number. Like, it's $150. And then the next time, they're fucking pissed at that client. They're like, Sarah doesn't appreciate me, this and this and this.
She doesn't even pay me my full amount.
She doesn't even pay me my full amount. Well, that's your fucking fault, first off. And then all of a sudden, they're like, it's $200 today. And Sarah's going like, well, I got the same thing as I got last time, but now it's $200 more. Then Sarah loses trust in you because you didn't act as the professional. That kind of took a left field. But like, honestly, I think that like artists are so guilty of doing that. And that's one of the changes that you must like make in your business. It might be hard. It might be hard to have those conversations with your clients and be like, hey, I'm having a price increase, or these are my prices, and this is what it is. But really, you have to set boundaries for yourself, or you will begin to resent the art.
Well, and I think you really, even before you're able to do that, you just have to acknowledge that where you're at now isn't where you want to be forever. Right. And even now, for example, when I moved to California, I moved into an apartment and I loved that apartment. It was super rad, right by the beach. And then I was there for about 3 years, which is crazy to think, or maybe 2.5 years, something like that. And then I moved into a house now. And the house I live in is so beautiful. It's in a neighborhood with only old people and I love it. They bake cookies and all this food that they drop off. They wave to me. I made best friends with an 82-year-old named Suzanne. She hit on Steven. She goes, are those off topic, but I'll get back. She goes, are those real tattoos? And he's like, yeah. And he has like a full sleeve and then a blacked out one. And she was just straight up like, if you were in my bed, I'd be nervous. I'm like,
y'all, did you say
that? And of course I'm in tears, but like, I love.
She said it like a flirty way.
I don't know. She touched his arm after and I was like, oh, okay, Suzanne, do we need to have a conversation about
Suzanne?
That? Okay. We're throwing down now. We're not. I want to be her when I'm 82. Yeah, she was rad. But even in that, I love where I live. But I'm already looking to the future. I look at Zillow every day just to like see what's out there.
Just entertain the option.
I want to entertain. And I've said it before, like I still have 3 more years in my lease, but it doesn't matter.
That's how I've gotten everything. My mom always jokes around. She goes, Danielle, you have this ability to will things in your way. I'm like, I'm always about entertaining options. Like literally, like I'm like, I want that house. I want that car. So instead of just like saying, oh, I wish that could be mine someday, I'm literally like, well, what does that look like?
And that's where I'm at now of like, you know what? I'm not ready to move yet. I still have my lease. I love where I'm at. I'm super happy.
But you can look into like, how do I save up? Where do I want to be?
And that's where I'm doing now. I started investing money pretty heavily, which has been like the scariest thing I've ever done because I don't gamble and it's too much like gambling. So where it like makes me sweat, but I'm making more money. So I'm like, okay, whatever.
I need to know about this.
I don't. I'm not a professional. I can give zero advice on any of this. It's very, very stressful. Honestly, my boyfriend helps me a lot. And I'm like, what are you investing in? I'm like, is it working? He's like, yeah. I'm like, cool, I'm going to invest in that thing. But like even things like that. But yes, and now I am entertaining the idea of different homes. And I literally set my Zillow. I'm like, it has to be in our area code. I don't want to say it, but like it has to be this area code. If it's not this area code, I don't want to live there. Does that mean the houses will be more expensive? Yes, it absolutely does. But I don't care. That's what I want. And I'm not willing to move farther away. Does it mean I'm ungrateful for my life? No. Does it mean I'm unhappy? No. It just means I'm not done.
Right.
And I will never be done. I will always say I was actually like, thank God for where I'm at now. And I'm so ridiculously grateful and appreciative for every turn my life has ever taken because I love my life. It's amazing. And it came with a lot of hard work. But that doesn't mean I have to just give up.
Right.
There's always something more. And it like saddens me when people are just like, I guess this is it for the next 80 years.
I almost get like when I feel I'm at that place, I'm like, I get a little depressed. I'm like, oh, and that's why I always refer to it. I'm like, I got to get back in the pocket. How did I leave the pocket? Like, where did I go? I like checked out. Like, life is about growing and seeing who you can become. And I can promise, like, you have nothing to lose to see who you can become. Like, literally, you have nothing to lose. And I feel like we coach so many artists, and I go to so many like events where it's just like, hype you up. And then no, everybody goes home and they get busy in the mundane things and they don't actually take the steps they need to because they have this either excuse that they're too busy or they have, you know, this running story of their kid's going to die if they walk to Starbucks or whatever it is. But honestly, just start little. Start with where you're at and make consistent targets. Entertain the idea. Map it out over the year.
Because you know what it is? There's a difference between hype and a plan. Mm. I get it. We've been to many events where it's hype up, hype up, hype up. Right. But fuck that. That's why the Academy was created, because we'll hype you up and we can motivate you. Mm-hmm. But now, like, okay, hype. Woo, let's do it. Do what? I don't know. That doesn't work.
Right.
And that's why the Academy was created. Okay, yeah. This is where you want to be. Great. We're all hyped for each other. Here's step one. You finish step one. Here's step two. You finish that. Here's step three. Great. And it walks you down the line to that path, as opposed to it being some motivational jerk off.
Yeah,
sorry. You put your hand up as I said it.
You know what's so crazy though? Now I'm gonna like totally lose my train of thought right out the door. Oh, in one of our last classes, I'm sitting there talking about the Academy and I'm like, you know, we have assistant training, we have marketing, we have da da da, and I'm like kind of listening at all the things. And I was like, listen, you guys, I'm gonna be real forward with you right now. I'm like, can I have a moment where I'm just really straightforward with you guys? All of you guys are here because you know you want to make changes in your business. Why would you pay $3,500 to come to a class if you didn't want to make changes in your business? Mm-hmm. I said, a lot of you need assistance. A lot of you need fire assistance. A lot of you guys need to burn your salons and probably start over. I don't know. But all of these things you know you need to do, you let 6 months go by, a year go by, 2 years go by, and you've done nothing. And that's what's so cool is like inside the Academy, with whether you're a new artist or you're an artist that's been behind the chair for 20 years and you have a salon that sucks, the Academy literally helps walk you through as an artist to make the changes that you know you need to do and gives you the permission and the accountability that you need to get it done faster.
So we are coming to the end of our podcast, which I love today. It was a potpourri of all of the thoughts we've had for all week.
We just did a training, and so I was like, what should we talk about? And like, we were kind of like all hyped up from our training.
In case you can't tell, we're jazzed.
You can always tell when we've just gotten done with the class or we're training, because the podcast is like, yeah! Like it's a little wild. And
so if you want to see us and our mannerisms and what happens behind the scenes, go to dkwstyling.com. And as always, if you have something that you want to us to talk about, like, just let us know.
And if you are interested in education, we have a few spots left for June's class.
Yeah.
And then that's like the last small class we have, I think, the whole year.
Literally. It is.
So like, if you are like, I don't know, I've been seeing these small classes, like this might be the last, because we have a lot of fulfillment events for the Academy that we do. And we also are planning a convention.
Which we'll talk about today.
We'll talk about later, but just know we have something, but small classes, this is your last opportunity for
and
the
last year. I think I saw there was like maybe 8 seats left, 6, something like that. Like it's selling out. It always does. So guys, thank you for being here with us. If you want any more information on our education, go to nbr.education. And hey, we'll see you next week.